University of Washington. I'm a casting director here in Baltimore, and this is my moment of spotlight.
Welcome on the spotlight, Six Shorty. Yeah, we have a very special guest down here today. We have Ms. Dale Washington, casting director. How you doing today?
Hey, I'm happy to be here. Thank you for having me.
For sure. I appreciate you coming on. So to get things started up, you know, we're currently in March, third month of the year. So yeah, so far, how's it been?
Trash. No, I'm not going to say that. I'm going to say that usually we've been blessed to have big films here. And so usually I have a film, I have a couple of commercials, a reality show, and things like that. And you always have to diversify as a independent contractor, as a, a big fish in a small pond. So that's one of the best things here. But because we don't have a film, it's like, whoa, you got to really get out and get it and get creative and shake hands and kiss babies and get some jobs and things rolling in because I'm my own boss, and I gotta make sure my team is good and I'm good, and you know, grown up bills.
Yeah. So when things are slow, what's kind of like? Do you kind of like take a step back, or you kind of like try to be like, I didn't find more opportunities?
Mm-hmm. You should always be finding opportunities because sometimes it takes a while to close a deal, to close a show. Sometimes people are getting the funding together. Sometimes the show could get put on hold. So you always have to be present, and you know, that's why I try to go live and do social media and things like that. And I started making myself come outside, go to networking events. But yeah, you have to always be there. And you know, eventually it comes, but I've realized that in most markets, when I talk to my colleagues, they always say that January and February is slow and then March picks up. But I never was affected because I was a big fish in a small pond. So I had everything jumping off, and we have close proximity to New York, DC, Philly. So I was getting all that work, and then national work as well. So, yeah.
I've been saying, like, every time I go on Instagram, you're on live. I like it though, because it's kind of like you're making yourself, like, essentially stay relevant.
Mm-hmm.
So is that kind of like a thing you do, like, daily, or?
Hell no. I try to go once a week. But I do it because, one, I want to educate this market. We have a huge tax break for filmmakers and things here, and I want people to get educated, and I want people to come here and know that we have actors that are ready. So I don't want people to come here and be like, oh, I gotta fly actors in from LA, or I gotta fly actors in or put them on a train from New York. I want them to know that we know how to show up, we know what a call time is, we know all the things. So I be telling y'all everything on Instagram. I make sure y'all know. I be telling y'all the real. I tell you when it's a scam. I tell you, you have opportunity. If I can't get it, this is how you get it yourself. So I try to educate the people so filmmakers will want to come here and know that we have a great pool of talent.
So talk about your early childhood. So your mother was like really, basically had like one foot in the industry. You know, you were around that a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So as a kid, like, how does that kind of play on your mindset? Like, cause you know, I think you said like you met Janet Jackson, you were like six.
Mm-hmm.
So you're being exposed to all these different things. So how does that kind of power your imagination? Like, all right, when I get older, I want to do this. Mm-hmm. I want to do that.
Yeah, it's terrible for your imagination because, you know, you try to get a regular plan. And I think that my mom saw a lot of things in the industry. And she probably was like, I want something more stable. So she wanted me to go the route of going to college and getting a good old government job, which I got invited to leave from. Wait, cut that out. I mean, go ahead, say. But, you know, I tried to work a government job. I tried to do all these different things. But because I was exposed to that, I felt like I needed more. I wanted to have more. And I feel like it's similar to when your parents are dentists. You want to be the next best dentist. You know, my dad a dentist, I want to be the oral surgeon, top, whatever. But because both of my parents were industry and were entrepreneurs, that's all I knew. I was miserable. And I'm a great worker. Like, I'm great, but that life just wasn't for me because I was exposed to so much, I believe.
I always think, like, I mean, I don't try to come to anybody that's 9 to 5, but I always think being an entrepreneur is, like, just the best field to be in. So, like, for you, like, I guess, you know, you work in a government job. So, like, talk to me about, you know, you've been in there and, like, just that other part of you that's like, bro, I know I can do this.
Yeah. So I worked a government job maybe 364 days. I got fired on the 365. Wow. I was young. I was back home from school because when I was in college, My first job was at Sony. So I did Sony marketing. I was working with some acts that's probably not around now, but I couldn't even pass out a T-Pain sampler because they didn't know who he was. It was rapper turned singer was his first thing before Buy You a Drink. So like John Legend, I had to pass out flyers, put them in my car. You know, just I had like the best job. It was like we were the Avengers. I couldn't believe that we got paid to do this. And we had like radio shows that we had to take them to and do their itineraries. We got these things called CDs back in the day. Nobody has a CD player anymore.
They don't. But I'm familiar with the CD. Wax.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. You know who Jay-Z is?
Sean
Carter.
My name is Sean. I got him.
Okay. Jay-Z. Okay. Okay. Cause like I be feeling old as hell. I be like, yeah, cause I know da da da, and they be like, who?
Fourth quarter of last year, there was a write-up done about you, you know, your earlier life, some of your past experiences, your work. And, you know, I'm reading the article, it's like this particular part kind of stuck out to me. So I think it was your friend that said, it was a friend and mentor, the costume supervisor, Kim Chewing, who told her to pick a lane. Be a stylist, be a casting director. If you could do both, you'll never fully be one or the other. She chose casting, probably because she loved the work, etc. So when it comes to like picking the lane, that process for you, how was that?
It was, I thought that making myself available to do all the things made me good. And for a while I did, but I eventually burnt out. Because when you're hungry, you're just so happy to be there. You want to get on, you want consistent work. But you also have to do market research for that market. So I started as a stylist and I did pretty well. I got into, my work is in the Smithsonian African American Museum. It won an award. I did, Beats by Dre commercials, styling Cam Newton. Like I did all those things, but I was like, how do I work regularly? Like, how do I get that regular check? And that was by doing a show. And from that show, I did all the jobs. And then I found out that I was grossly underpaid, but I was just like, this is my chance to get on. Like, it was so, people don't even want to show up to set because they don't want to come from East Baltimore to West Baltimore. But for almost a year, I drove to Georgetown, D.C. every day in traffic, worked 13 hours and came back. And most television shows have like a team of maybe like 15, 10. It was only like four of us. And it was a show on a network. And I eventually started as the stylist and the casting director quit. And I was like, I do that shit all the time. I got you. And so I didn't, but I figured it out, you know. And then eventually, like, the production company, it's Story House. The show was called Copycat Killers. It's on a network called, not ID, but Reels. It was my first show. And I was like, if I can get through this, this is going to open me up to other opportunities. And this is going to be basically my film school. And I'm gonna kill this. I don't care if I'm being underpaid. I don't care if they are, you know, undercutting me by having me do all the things. So I thought that because I was opened up to casting, I could still accept styling. Cause I even got with an agent in Georgetown as well, ironically. But I was wearing myself thin, you know? Like, styling is hard. And it is, people think you just be like, oh, yeah, I'm going to put you in that. No, you have to, first of all, actors be lying about what size they wear. They, you know, it's just a lot of stuff, right? So a makeup artist can just be like, oh, okay, you look this color. They can just carry one thing. A stylist, to fill up their rack, they probably got to go through all of these different stores and then make sure they have your size and make sure it's what the you know, it's appropriate to the year or the idea that the director has. And then sometimes on commercials, you got to deal with the director and the client, and then you got to take all that stuff back. And then sometimes when you get into the high fashion, you know, they might mess up a shirt that's like $5,000, but your budget's only 1,000. And then you got to wait 30 days to get paid after you done charged up all of your cards.
And you got
to
repay that?
No. Well, it depends on, you can do certain situations. You can get something on loan. The production company can pay you to shop or give you a card, but certain things they want to take back. So maybe somebody's trying it on and they got makeup on it and the store won't take it back and they only tried it on. So it's like a lot of anxiety and clothes and things. Like, something, some bullshit can cost like $400 and it go missing. And somebody think like, oh, let me just take this shirt. But what's the Yeezy? It look like some homeless shit. Somebody take it home and it's like, yeah, we short. You know what I'm saying? Or, yeah, so it was a lot. And I realized with casting, I could do that from home. And I could spend more time with my son. I could make my schedule around it. So I gave it up. So I wasn't like, you know, a master of none and just spreading myself thin. So I decided to give casting 110%, and I did. And I'm glad for Kim. At first, when she said it, I was mad as shit. Like, what you mean? Like,
I think that's authentic, though. That's yeah. a real friend. Because I think she kind of like, she sees your potential and what you can do. Because I'm not going to lie, with the styling, it kind of seems like, I mean, nothing wrong with being a perfectionist, but I think it's kind of hard to be a perfectionist when you're the one trying to be it and the next person's kind of not. Now, I say your clients weren't, but like, you're trying to perfect you and them.
Mm-hmm.
So that seems a little bit more difficult, in my opinion. So no, Kim is a real one for that.
She is. And she's actually head of the costume departments for We Own the City.
So you know you're into directing. So talk to me about like the director's eye. Because you know, like, your outlook on your perspective is different from mine because I don't direct. So like, do you find yourself having like critique things a lot or anything like that?
Absolutely. But I want to be clear. So you have a casting director, and then you have a regular director. Okay. So we're a little different. Casting directors really don't come to set like that, but we help paint the picture of what the director, the client, or the character wants from us. And so we have to be creative to make them see that this is your person, or, you know, this person may not look exactly like what we're looking for, but their talent is like phenomenal, or this person is easy to work with, or this person is so talented, but they're a fucking asshole and you're gonna regret hiring them. I mean, we don't do like the do not cast, but we do, you know, like to say like, yo, they are gonna kill it, but they might be late or they might be an asshole to deal with.
So like, how do you like approach that though? You know, cause you know, you cast somebody, it might be like the best time in the world, but sometimes, like you said, they might be an asshole or they might be late.
Mm-hmm. So I call it a Thea talking to, right?
Okay.
It's a lot of people who have had a Thea talking to. I don't know, you might see it in the comments, but it's like where I give you some tough love. Like, I'm gonna talk to you like, you know, hey, don't be up here acting crazy, making me look crazy, you know? And that's not cool. That's not what we agreed to, because sometimes actors don't know that all of us, especially in this community, we're all tight. Like, we talk. So sometimes they'll be like, oh yeah, casting didn't tell me that, but they don't know that Bird is my homie. So he gonna be like, yo, I mean, I ain't gonna say you snitching, but you know, like, if, all right, that's a bad example. Bird don't snitch. but Bird does have my back, and a lot of people on set have my back, so that, you know, I know if someone, like actors, they'll be a certain way in front of me. But then when they get to set, they're like, she didn't tell me anything, or this is not what I agreed to, and blah, blah, blah. But if you get an email from me, it is very specific, very detailed. And then we call you over the phone. So it's like, they know. They work with me. They know that my people are together. So I give them a Thea talking to, and it's like, you know, you got to get it together, or this ain't going to work out for us in the future.
I ain't like, y'all do not want that Thea talking to you. Y'all do not want that. I'm telling you right now, I can only imagine.
Yeah, it's like Mama, but also East Baltimore.
For sure.
And very, you know, it's, I try to be professional. So yeah, but it gets real.
No, actually, but I think you gotta be like, you kind of gotta be direct though, especially in this line of business. Cause I think if you beat around the bush and you just tell them, oh, you're doing good, but just kind of turn it, it ain't really gonna take you seriously. So you kind of gotta be, you know, assertive in a sense.
In a sense, but for women, it's harder because. Like I was saying when I came here, we, even as parents, it's harder, and then a mom, but women, we have to look a certain way. We have to also be feminine. We can't be too bossy, and then we're, you know, all of a sudden a bitch, or we're difficult in things, and it's certain things in a fine line that I try to walk so that I'm advocating for myself, but not being, pushed over. You know, like, it's easy for people to discount you and push you over, especially when you are a minority, when you're in a market like this, and especially when you're a woman. So, yeah, it's hard.
Twitter every day, I'm scrolling, doing my daily scrolling, about a group, 10 minutes. And I come across this tweet. It says, "Women, this is how they be. I want a guy who is financially established and he makes more money than I do." You're currently engaged right now, but from a female's perspective, if you came across a guy, you know, you really deal with him and he makes more money than you, would you kind of like, is it kind of like proud on how you deal with him or like the outlook on him?
There's a lot of women, they will deal with a guy who makes more money than them, but sometimes they might treat him like shit. Or that means like, oh yeah, he got money, but it's what are you willing to deal with? You know, the guy that makes less might have potential and might be here and he might have better morals or he might have earning power. Just because you make less, it doesn't mean that you're less of a catch. You know, he might be able to stay home with the kid while you go and grind and get it and be an excellent father and you not have to look for childcare. That's saving money, keeping it in there,
right.
You know, or, you know, I think finances are very important. However, what is the potential there? What are you getting with it? You know, and what are you bringing to the table? Because I feel like, you know, women might say that, but guys be like, she got to have a big ass, a small waist, this and that. And they be looking like, grr, you know what I'm saying? Right. So what if my grandmother says this all the time. And when she told me this a while ago, I had an attitude. I was like, that's fucked up. But she said, you not Cinderella, so you ain't going to get Prince Charming.
He was that blunt? You ain't Cinderella?
Yo, you got to meet my grandmother.
I need you.
So basically, when she was like, you can't have, and I don't think she said it to me. I feel like she said it to somebody else, but she said that shit. But, oh, am I allowed to cuss?
You done had about 30 customers.
Okay, cool. But it's basically like, you know, what do you want? Like, are you being realistic with your expectations? You know, do you want this and you're not bringing this to the table? Do you want this and what's that? And what are you willing to sacrifice to have this man with the dollars? Because every man with the dollars ain't going to treat you like a princess. You know, he might have dollars, but he may not support you, you know?
No, that's fair. You know, money is power. And essentially, I think, like, I need to tell your grandma. She really put that into perspective for me.
Yeah.
And especially with coming, like, I can speak from a male perspective because I'm a man. But, you know, you're dealing with a man with some, you know, dollars. Okay, well, he got dollars, but he probably got less time. So mm-hmm. you got to take that into account. And then, as you know, you're a man, you're dealing with a female who makes more than you. I like how you said it's not about that money. He probably can be a stay-at-home dad. He's probably good with the kids. It's like, it seemed like you kind of put it into perspective with it, though. You're willing to maneuver.
Mm-hmm.
And I like that. That's how you're supposed to be. Because, you know, I think a lot of females, the mass majority of them, and I'm not trying to be biased, but I'm just being realistic. It's 2023.
Okay.
You know.
I'm ready for this. What you about to
for
say?
For sure. I ain't going to lie. If you make less than your girl, she ain't cheating like you, my man. She not. Don't look at me like that. She not. Not all of them. Not all of them, but I don't think so. Cause I think a lot of females, like, they, especially my age though, you know, we kind of like a age gap. So it's kind of like, I'm speaking for me, I think like, if you make less than a female, she not really gonna respect you.
That's not the truth.
You don't think so?
I don't think that's the truth. Cause it's like, what females, first of all, where's this pool of females that you're pulling from? Is this like bad bitch females, the IG model,
or city girls? I'm talking about.
These are city. Oh hell no, they ain't gonna respect you. Hell no, they a city girl. They told you what they want. Cut the check, you know. But if you're dealing with a lot of women who can see you have potential, or to see where you're going, or to see like, hey, I got extra money. Maybe we can put this into marketing your show, or just certain things, because you eventually might be the one making more later. Like, you 22. You're just getting started. Everybody, you know, like, you got so much money and so much time, and you're already ahead of the game because you have this beautiful production, you got sponsors, you're doing your thing, and this is going to build into something real. I mean, not real, but, like, real big is what I meant to say. So you already ahead of the game for your age. Like,
nah, I appreciate it.
Yeah.
But
leave them city girls alone. Leave them city girls alone.
You got to. So, you know, being that you're into directing, right? Say if you had, you know, cast a movie about your life, who would you want to play you? And Ooh. Who would you want the moral of the movie to be about?
I would say All right. Maybe Dominique Fishback.
Okay.
Or I like Moses Ingram. I like Scotty and all those dope Baltimore actresses. It's so many dope Baltimore actresses. So I feel like it has to be somebody from Baltimore so they could say two and do. But I feel like Dominique could do that. Like, she's so talented. And I like her because she's like, she's built like a real girl. You know, like, I'm not very petite and I'm, you know, woman, thick. So I like her. And what would the premise of my story be? My life is wild. I mean, not wild. I mean, it's just, wow, I'm here. So I would say, whoo, that's a good one. That's a great question.
She never asked this
before. I've never answered this before. So, I guess it would kind of be like a mix between, it was this book called Fly Girl, and it was about a coming of age story, a girl, but she wasn't from Baltimore. So maybe like the Baltimore version of Fly Girl, kind of mixed with D. Watkins' book, how he had like all his memoirs and he kind of like pieced it together. So how, what I love about being from Baltimore is that it's like a tale, not of two cities, like the book, but like a tale of five cities. So it's like, I feel like I live so many different lives. So I would love to see the young Thea getting put out of city, you know, or working, lying about my age at No Limit Communications so I could be the manager at like 14. Shout out to Teresa, Greenmount Avenue. Or just like, just overcoming and just being, I don't know. I have a great life. Like it wasn't always easy, but I just feel very blessed to be here because there are a lot of people who are not here. And to grow up. Oh my God, you Oprah. Like, shit. But to grow up in Baltimore.
Hey, bro. We keeping that you, I ain't gonna lie.
Nah, man. But to grow up here, you lose a lot of people.
Yeah, no, for sure. I understand.
So.
Yeah, no, definitely.
I feel blessed to be here and be in this position. Sorry, I lost, like, it made me go back to growing up and, like, you know, I got friends that straight-A students, they drugs, you know. And I didn't even think people did drugs, like hard drugs when I was in high school. Or like killed or like just different stuff. And or just even family like passing away that you wish was here to see. You know, they saw me when I was like bad as shit, but they didn't get to see that I turned out okay. So I guess that's what made me emotional because it's like, I could be anybody. I could have ended up, you know, in jail. I could have ended up, you know, Teen Mom, even though Teen Moms be winning, shout out to Ronnie. But I was, so many people have spoken things over my life because I was not a straight A student. I was not, you know, I wasn't a lot of things. And I just feel blessed to be here. And you have to watch what you say over people because you don't, especially children, you know, teachers have told me terrible things, you know, and I could be, that's why I have so much compassion because I feel like I could be anyone, you know, like being young and dumb, driving in a car because there's drugs in the car. I could be in jail for the rest of my life. You know, I'm not snitching on myself. You're not Vlad, but like, but it's just like, I guess coming from here, you kind of have like almost a survivor's remorse for the people that didn't survive or didn't come out with you or, yeah. Cause any of us, like, I just hate when people come from the city and get success and then be trying to shit on everybody else that didn't come out because the system is really stacked against us. And if you come out, you have to come back and build in. And that's why I'm grateful for We Own the City, not just linking with all of my favorite people, from Bird to D Watkins to Kim to Donna to Ghazi, like all of us Baltimore people working on the Baltimore project, but we got to employ over 5,000 people from the hood.
That's dope. You gave them a great opportunity that they probably didn't even see themselves getting at one point.
So many, yo, I swear, like, the love is real. Like, oh, and Larry, too, my brother Larry. people were able to start their career as actors and pay off child support or, you know, probation fees and just different things like that. So I just feel really blessed to be in my situation because I could have been anywhere.
I think that the fact that you're able to understand where you come from and still have like a authentic side, basically, because, you know, like you said, a lot of people, it's like I experienced it myself. Like, people from here, they get like, you know, some fame, notoriety, whatever you want to call it, and they kind of act different. They're like, they forget what they passed. But I think I really see like the connection with you and your past, and you understand like, okay, I was here, but now I'm here, but I'm still. This is still me. And you understand that it's people are still at that point. And the fact that you're able, you know, to offer all those jobs, opportunities, that's all I think. That's real.
Yeah.
That's real. Because I know me. And, like, some people that I know, if y'all came, some people just doing all this stuff, and y'all, like, bro, y'all trying to be in that movie with Young Moose, and we're not, we're on the city, we're going to cash out. They're like, hell yeah, bro. What? They didn't smile for the camera, everything. So that's authentic. That's real. You got. Honestly, I say you need to give yourself your flowers. Do you give yourself your flowers enough? You think that?
Probably not. Cause I'm just working for the next. You know, it's like, what's
that's
next?
That's how I be. But if you don't give them to you, nobody else is gonna give them. People won't give them to you. But it means something. But I don't think it means something that you give them to yourself. Cause anybody can say you doing good or that a boy. You feel me? Or good job. But I think when you really take a time and be like, I'm here.
Yeah.
That's when it really matters.
Yeah, I mean, well, thank you for this because I never, like, look. Damn. All right, cut this.
That influence you have with people, did that ever, like, get to you? Do you ever, like, ever cross your mind?
No.
It doesn't?
People full of shit. Because they, like, you know, like, I don't let it go to my heart and I don't let it go to my head because they love you 1 minute, they hate you the next. So I don't do that. Like, I don't know. Maybe that's why I don't give myself my flowers, because I'm like, I'm just working. I'm just doing my job. And, you know, my job just happens to be putting my city on. So, you know, I'm grateful. Because for many years, I didn't really get a lot of jobs casting a lot of black people. Okay. And it would probably be like, you know, the token black or me saying, hey, it's all white people, or it's all light-skinned people. Where the black people at? So I feel really honored. And thank you for that question. It made me reflect where I came from, where I'm at. Because you just be living, and life be lifing. And you just, like, every day I'm working, I'm momming, I'm, you know, fiance, and trying to hold it together. So, I mean, I'm giving myself my flowers. I'm proud of myself. Yeah.
I want y'all to take a break and give all flowers. You know? Nah, for sure. I'm on Instagram. I'm scrolling once again, and I come across this. So it's kind of like a virtual event for, I guess, upcoming actors. So just talking about this opportunity, you know, you connecting with people that, you know, want an opportunity to act and feel.
Okay. This is one of the classes that I do, and I'm excited because I get to connect with different actors. Or people that are thinking about acting, and just show them how to do certain things or why they're not getting booked, and just to help them. And one thing I want people, especially if they are watching this and they're actors, I want them to realize that by living in Baltimore, which was once the wealthiest city in America, because of its proximity to DC, to New York, to Philly and Virginia, all of these places have film offices. They all give productions tax breaks. So films are usually being filmed anywhere. So as long as you got a car, you can work nonstop. But I just want you to be prepared so you can get a call back. Yeah.
No, I think this is a good opportunity because how I look at things, I don't never go into anything without being prepared. And for a lot of these young actors, getting to learn from you, getting to take some points from you, I think that's really going to, like, you know, put them a step further than the average Joe just walks in there, oh, I need a role. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So, no, I think that's would be a great opportunity. Speaking of acne, you know, y'all recently just shot We Own This City. And I know Young Woosh was featured on there. It's a big part about, you know, his story, his running with, I can't think of the cop's name. I think it was Herschel.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know, working with Young Woosh on that project, how was that?
I love Moose.
Okay.
Bert, you was there when, like, we have, Moose is, I don't know if, I thought he was going to say, I was like, were you there when he said they had him on camera, and I thought he was going to be like, oh, Thea's a big sister to me or whatever like that. Mm-hmm. And he was like, yeah, I love Thea like a mother. And I was like, nigga, don't nobody want to be like your mother. Like, the hell? But that's my guy. I love him. I'm proud of him. And I think that he actually has an opportunity to have a great career. D. Watkins wrote episode 3 that featured Moose, and he, D don't ask nobody for nothing. I don't know, you had D on the show.
I did. I had him 2 guests ago. Shout out to D. Watkins.
Yeah, him and Karan, his wife, that's actually one of my best friends from childhood. And I used to lie and be like, yeah, I'm with Karan, mommy. Yeah. But yeah, she's my alibi. But no. No, they are beautiful people, amazing people. But he wrote the hell out of episode 3. And he just was like, Thea, I just want to make sure you get Moose to play himself. Because a lot of times actors, they don't have a connection to the role. And he would probably hate to see some corny dude that goes to like, yeah, I'm Carlton, you know, like, yeah, whatever. Yeah, what up? You know what I'm saying? Like, so I reached out. He reached out. D reached out. Bird reached out. All of us reached out. And our first interaction wasn't so great. But once he came at me, and then I gave him a Thea talking to, we saw eye to eye.
So who's got a Thea talking to?
He definitely did. Yeah, it's all love. Like, because, I mean, I saw his point of view 100% because he didn't know a lot of the information. He was traumatized by this guy. And this man put his mom in jail. And he was about to blow the fuck up. But every time he would do a show, he actually did a show. You got to get Tracy Stafford on here. But he was about to do a show with Tracy, which is one of my best friends. Okay. And he came and got locked up. So it was like people were losing money.
Wow.
And, you know, everybody be like, I ain't do it, man. I ain't do nothing. He really didn't do anything. And that's why We Own the City was so important, number one, for him to play himself, but two, to get the word out there, because people always trust the cops and think just because we, you know, we might have a past, we might have a record, or we just regular people from Baltimore City, they don't believe us, and they believe the cop over us. But really, he did nothing. I mean, I'm not saying perfect, but in those situations where he got locked up, it was nothing that he did.
He was innocent.
He was just being harassed by him.
Right.
But Moose did so great that on set, first of all, we practiced via FaceTime and we did the audition. And of course he got the role, but his memory, the way he didn't miss a line.
Last year for you, like the full quarter, you had like it was like really major. You had like a lot of events going on, articles, and you did a video for Nike.
Yeah.
Work with Nike all together, you know, it's just like a major opportunity. Swoosh, you feel me? But you also got a video repost on that commercial by Drake. So that whole accomplishment, how was that?
Ma!
Didi, you alright?
Where are the shoes?
Oh, the shoes?
Ma, where are the shoes?
Aunt Mary stopped by with cousin Ronnell on the way to school and I gave them to him.
What?
I gave them to cousin Ronnell.
It was amazing, but I don't get paid in likes and reposts. And Drake is dope. That's, you know, I've been with him. He was on my MySpace page back in the day, you know, when he was a mixtape rapper. However, the biggest thing from this was working with Marawi Garima. Marawi Garima.
Okay.
Yes. He is one of the upcoming directors. Like, first of all, his dad is like the messiah of black film and cinema. He's amazing. But to have a black director that understands the people and just sees the vision. And I knew it was going to be dope, but I didn't know it was going to be like this. And I just really loved working with him because he's a visionary, but also he's like, cool. He like good people, you know, and he comes from like a legacy. So the way it came together, I was like, this was probably, I think, one of my favorite commercials I ever did, but it was for Nike Nocta, Drake's brand. But working with this was definitely one of my favorite, and to have all these beautiful black kids starring in it, speaking roles. When you see the long version, it's gonna make you want a whole movie. Like,
okay,
it's an extended version of this. I'm gonna send to you for sure. Mm-hmm.
For this, yeah, what's one of the products that you're most like looking forward to working on?
Whatever pays me well, doesn't stress me out, and doesn't try to micromanage me. That's what I'm looking forward to. The big dollars, low stress, and something that allows me to use my expertise and discover some creativity and some new faces and some new people. That's what I'm looking forward to.
Okay, so our product, as long as they just had those, follow those guidelines.
Yeah, don't stress me out. Don't micromanage me. Nobody really micromanages me, but sometimes projects can be very stressful.
Right.
And I like to live a well-balanced life because my first priority is my family, my fiance, and my kid. And I want to have time for them. I want to have some me left where I'm not tired, where I'm not stressed out, where, so it's good to work in good environments. So I love working with Marawi. And I'm excited to see what he has coming next. So more projects with him, D. Watkins, and just being, you know, Bird, my peoples, Larry. Projects where is creativity, is love, and a great check. That's the dream.
All that check. The family, your son Bruce Wayne, bro. If y'all know who Bruce Wayne is, that's Batman. That's the miniature version of Batman. Like, his name is literally Bruce Wayne. You feel me? You know, your son, Bruce Wayne, he just turned 8 years old yesterday.
Yes, he did.
So when it comes to, like, parenthood, what's like some do's and don'ts you'll get to, like, I guess new parents or just anybody's with your parents?
If you are a parent, you got one job, and that is to protect your child, you know. And protection means more than just making sure they don't get hurt or, you know, but making sure you have them around the right people. And making sure that you feed into their dreams, their hopes, and their confidence. And make sure you don't tear them down too much, because we'd be like, oh, you being too this, too that. No, they need that in this world, because this world is going to tear them down. So make sure you are real with your kids and you're honest and just loving and don't grow them up. But that money will be there if you can get your kids and love on them as much as you can and be there for them. And, you know, because they're not going to be little no more. I can't believe I got an 8-year-old. Like, that's crazy to me. So it's just been a joy watching him grow up and just being there and seeing his personality and his little vibe. And, you know, like, he's a sneaker guy. I think he got shit sneakers on.
Oh, no, bro, I can adjust. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. He's a sneaker guy, so he likes to clean and design sneakers. And, you know, I'm excited to see where he's going to go. But with parents, do whatever by any means to protect and love on your child, because you don't want to fuck your child up and pay for therapy later.
Yeah, you know.
So.
What you do now is going to pay up. It's going to dictate what happens in the long run.
Yeah.
Nah, definitely understood.
I don't feel like it's a parenting manual, because sometimes people can do all the right things and their kid,
and
you know.
It still, you know, has some little.
Yeah. But there is no parenting manual because every child is not the same. Every child is different. Certain people need different things. You know, some kids might need structure and some kids might need a little grace. So it's just identifying what child you have. And, you know, they always say in the serial killer movies, like, oh, they had the perfect family and the perfect parents and they turned out to be a serial killer. Yeah. So it's just like you just always want to make sure you're doing the right thing and check in with your child and F all that be seen and not heard. And, you know, listen to your kid. They got some things to say. And, you know, their feelings matter. And if you're wrong, apologize. You know, our parents were in survival mode. And I feel like our generation of parents, you know, we're coming out of survival mode into let's build these beautiful humans to take this thing to the next level and just be, you know, a good person. Like, I don't give a damn if he go to college or, you know, I would want him to, but I mean, I don't even know if I care. I just want him to be fulfilled and be happy and be loved and just be his authentic self. Like, right now, his confidence level is here. I wanted to stay there. He's brilliant. He's a straight A student. I failed through. I don't know how I graduated, but yeah, I'm like, where did this kid come? Like, he's so dope. And everybody thinks their kid is dope, but my Bruce Wayne, he really is. Like, you got to show them the wrestling video. Cause
okay, Bruce.
My son is that guy.
Go back into the interview.
Okay, cool.
I got you. You know, before we wrap things up, I want to know, because you know, you did a lot in your lifetime, a lot of experiences, a lot of accomplishments. And, you know, sometimes it's not really fair, but more so lessons. If you go back to, like, this one moment in your life, I guess it made me for one, what moment would that be?
You about to make me cry again. No, I ain't gonna cry. If I could go back to any moment, what would it be? I don't want to go back.
You don't?
I don't. I like where I am now because I feel like everything is working together the way it's supposed to be. Like, I feel like I don't have to prove myself. I feel loved. I'm in a happy relationship. You know, I feel like my son is proud of me. I feel like my parents finally get it. You know, they're finally proud of me, you know, because everyone doesn't get the vision. So when you don't have that support, you can't be mad at them because God didn't give that to them, you know?
Nah, you can't be mad.
So you have to just keep it moving and don't take it personal. Don't be like, oh, F my family, they don't get why I'm doing this or whatever. Like, they don't know. They don't know. And sometimes you have to communicate how to support you. You know, all support isn't financial. Sometimes it's time. Sometimes it's like, yo, I might need a ride. Or, yo, just repost it. It's free. It costs nothing to repost it. Or comment to help the algorithm. Or, you know, help me decorate this set, something. But you have to tell people how to support you and how to love you. And make sure that they do. Everybody that isn't supporting you the way you think you should, sometimes they just don't know. Everybody isn't an entrepreneur, you know? And I used to take it so personal and be so pissed when people ain't get the vision. But now I don't even take it personal. But I just feel like where I am now is a beautiful space. You know, I like the car I drive. I love where I live. I love my stepkid, well, my soon-to-be stepkids and my son and me and my mom getting along. My dad is cool. You know, both of my parents are here on this earth. So I just feel like every other time it was just, this was right, but that wasn't quite. Or, you know, now it's beautiful for me. I got the right people in my space. I got the right friends. I have people that genuinely love and support me, and it wasn't always like that, so I don't want to go back.
No, I get it. I've been there myself, especially when people don't understand your vision. And you'll be thinking in here like, bro, it's clear as day.
Mm-hmm.
But they can't foresee that. You said that God didn't give them that plan. No, I definitely understood that. You got any last shout-outs? You want to make any final words? You want to leave us off a little sign?
What you want me saying? Sorry.
Everything you got to do. I'm going to be sitting here quietly.
What do I want to say? What do I want to do? Man, I'm just in a place of gratitude at this point in my life. Not saying everything is perfect or everything is easy, but I'm just grateful to be in this space. And I'm grateful that you invited me here. I'm proud of what you're doing. I'm proud of what Bird is doing with the space. I saw what it looked like before and where it is now. This is beautiful. And, you know, I just want everybody in Baltimore to know, like, it's a way. Like, you can still dream. You can still dream. You can redirect your life at any given time. You can decide, like, I want different. And now we have YouTube University, where you can go online, figure anything out. They didn't have Google back in my day. We had a damn library with a encyclopedia to figure things out. So I just want everyone to maximize on technology and just change their space and just speak into themselves. And I love how, you know, you're 22, but you're like, do you give yourself your flowers? So I want people to be cognizant of what they put into their body, not just the food, but what are you listening to? You know, what are you surrounding yourself with? Who are you surrounding yourself with? Because healthy diets aren't just what you ingest. As far as food, but what you ingest and what you listening to in your self-talk. So I want everybody inspired by you to love themselves more and to, you know, love each other and just, yeah, just be real, you know?
Nah, for sure. I appreciate that. Thank you for coming on.
Thank you for having me. For sure. Yes.
Like I said, 6 show of the year. Y'all heard it first. Y'all know what's going on. Moment spotlight. I want y'all to stay tuned, stay prepared for your moment spotlight. Y'all. You know what I'm saying?
Yes. Hey. I didn't know you was open.